Hello. Today I'd like to share my ideas about the promise of human rights. I think today it's a funny or strange thing to talk about the promise of human rights. Certainly at the forefront of our minds, we might be thinking about the problems with ISIS and its response from governments around the world. We see here, of course, the US response to ISIS as well as other coalition governments and how they respond to the crisis in ISIS. Also, if we think back over many years, the first 15 years of the 21st century, we might see, for example, the response of the United States to the attacks of 9/11. And here, of course, we see the US Patriot Act, which many have argued centralized executive authority and undermined long-fought rights traditions in the history of the United States. A logical consequence of this, one might argue, could have been the Camp Delta at Guantanamo Bay. Here in the UK, terrorism legislation that was made permanent before 9/11 was consolidated and solidified in ways that allowed more executive authority here in the UK, and uses of powers by the police and other agencies of the state have been criticized as being too powerful and undermining rights. We also see, of course, some of the logical consequences of a new thinking around human rights in response to terrorism. This project here, based at the University of Kent, for example, shows rendition flights around the world and participation of governments that seem somewhat counterintuitive in that system. In fact, it's estimated that up to 54 countries have participated in extraordinary rendition. In addition to that, recently the political party conference, particularly within the Conservative Party here in the United Kingdom, has said it had plans to roll back the UK Human Rights Act. The UK Human Rights Act actually domesticates international or European human rights law here within the United Kingdom. So you might think that we might be a bit pessimistic about the status of human rights here in the UK and abroad. But I'm going to share with you some information that comes from research based here at the University of Essex as well at other universities that looks at the longer term developments in the world. If we stretch back into the latter years of the 19th century all the way until now, we see that, for example, the growth of democracy since the end of the 19th century until now has been quite extraordinary. There was a dip towards authoritarianism in the 1960s and 1970s, but a growth towards democracy in the later years of the 20th century and certainly in the first years of the 21st. If we also look at data concerning what are the benefits of that growth in democracy, there is a strong positive relationship between nominal institutional elements of democracy and the protection of civil and political rights. And some of you in the audience might be thinking, yes, but there are some countries that fall well below that line and might suggest that there are some easy wins for the procedures of democracy, but that rights protection have lagged far behind. If we look at military coups that have taken place over the years, there's been a steep decline in the use of military coups for changing governments and for staying in government. Equally, if we look at data on conflict in the world, there's been a secular decline in the overall level of conflict since 1992. And that decline in conflict is something that we should welcome in the world, despite our preoccupations today with conflict in the Middle East at the forefront of our minds. But what about human rights? Since the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948, there's been a growth and proliferation in the international law of human rights. Treaties, treaty bodies, monitoring mechanisms, and participation of states have all grown dramatically over the period since 1948. One could say that the international regime of human rights has grown in breadth and in depth, which is to say there are now more treaties for more rights than ever before, and there are more states participating in that international regime than ever before. Again, the skeptic might argue that that's just a commitment, that's sort of an in-principle commitment, but what happens in practice? Analyzing data here as part of the Human Rights Atlas Project based at the University of Essex, we can map the protection and violation of human rights using standard scales, for example, the state terror scale or political terror scale mapped over the world. Here we see an early 1980s picture of the world, and as the world changes through the 1990s, the turn of the century, and today. That doesn't really show us what's happening over time. So if we take these scales and look at them over time, comparing one to the other, where the top end of the scale is a violation of human rights and the low end of the scale is a protection of human rights, we see that over this period, there's been a slight protection of human rights that has decreased in the middle period, but then got slightly better at the end of the period. Now, there's been one argument that because we are more aware of human rights, we might be measuring them differently in the world. And a new study just published in the American Political Science Review shows that if we take into account this increasing standard of accountability, that actually protection of human rights has got better over time, and that we should be quietly confident that the world is actually a safer place, even though it doesn't seem like it today if we read the headlines. So what lies behind all of this? What do the politics of human rights tell us? What does this sort of motivation and mobilization around the idea of human rights tell us? In-depth research has shown a number of stylized claims around the promotion and protection of human rights from a political point of view. For example, we see that domestic struggles for rights can lead to political transition, which brings about their better protection. We have studies that say that transnational struggles for human rights can also lead to better protection. This is a struggle that starts domestically and then involves international actors at that transnational level, international non-governmental organizations, international governmental organizations that put pressure on states to change their practices. States do not exist in a vacuum, but they're interrelated with other states and with this transnational layer of mobilization. We also know that transitional justice mechanisms have a benefit for human rights. Those countries that undertake transitional mechanisms like truth commissions, local trials, courts, etc., have a tangible benefit for human rights in the future. And finally, that participation in an international regime of human rights, ratifying treaties and taking part in the international system, have tangible benefits for the protection of human rights. And one of my favorite recent studies is a study by Heather Smith Kanoy called Insincere Commitments, in which he said the initial motivation of states to become involved in this system might be insincere, which is to say if they ratify a treaty, they might have international aid and assistance from other governments. But in the long run, the law has bite that comes back and allows people to mobilize around particular rights claims. Equally, I think precedents have been set in the last few years. Certainly at the end of the 20th century, one of the biggest precedents set happened here in the United Kingdom. I was on my way to Venice to teach on a human rights and democracy program, and while I was flying, the United Kingdom detained Augusto Pinochet. His detention was done on the grounds of an extradition request from the government of Spain, with which the United Kingdom has an agreement. He was kept here in the United Kingdom for quite some time under house arrest, as the legal system here decided whether he could be held accountable for being a former head of state who had been allegedly responsible for human rights abuses. In the end, the law lords decided that he could be detained. The law lords decided that a former head of state could be held culpable for acts committed whilst being head of state. This set a precedent for the concept of universal jurisdiction, something that had been struggled for since the 1920s and came to fruition with the opening and promulgation of the Rome Statute, which set up the International Criminal Court. This buttressed local arguments for the culpability of former heads of state. Some 15 years later, a former head of state in Guatemala was tried in a domestic court. General Rios Montt was in charge of Guatemala in the early 1980s, where there was a spike in killings, particularly amongst the indigenous community. In fact, statistical analysis showed that if you were an indigenous person living in a particular region in Guatemala, you were 8 times more likely to have been killed by the state. Now, the statistics don't prove intentionality, but they certainly are showing something that can't happen by random chance alone. And I think that argument held weight in the proceedings against Rios Montt. He was actually found guilty on known procedural grounds. The trial result was annulled and set back, and we're now awaiting a second trial in this year. But the precedents set there are important. We can see that universal jurisdiction has applicability, and a domestic court within the case of Guatemala has led to that result. Only 2 weeks ago, a further case is developing for the murder of Jesuit priests, a maid, and her daughter in El Salvador that took place in 1989. Precisely the arguments that were used against Pinochet and Rios Montt are being advanced against the perpetrators of that horrible crime. It's in the very early stages of that case, but there is, because of what happened here in the United Kingdom, the arguments around human rights, there has been advance for this particular case. So what does all of this mean at an individual level? You and I are sitting here thinking about, we have these rights, we can exercise our rights, but in what way do they motivate us? What is the internal motivation for a struggle for rights? And I was struck by an interview with someone from Raqqa a few weeks ago on Radio 4 who was fighting ISIS. And a number of his colleagues had perished in that struggle against ISIS, but he believed that his organization monitoring their activities and struggling against them was worth it. And the quote was, "We want democracy and freedom in our country, and that motivates us for what we're doing." I take that quote at face value and reference an older quote about repression. Repression that maybe sits within inside us, or repression that we experience against us. But if we sit here repressed in any way, imagine what can be unleashed, says Grodek, when that repression is lifted or we break free of it. And to me, that is a massive motivation that we see around the world demonstrated throughout a variety of settings. So for example, I want to tell you about a tale of three women. In the 1970s, these three women were political, or two of the women of the three were political prisoners of their states. The third woman was a political prisoner under house arrest a little bit later in this period. The first woman is Michelle Bachelet, who was arrested and detained and ultimately exiled by the Pinochet government in Chile. She's now been elected president of Chile twice. If you had asked me in 1970, what's the probability that Michelle Bachelet would be the president of Chile, I would have said it's near zero. But imagine the promise and the hope that someone like her and her story gives to young people around the world today. Over 30 years of struggle inside Michelle Bachelet, and she's elected president twice. My second person is Aung San Suu Kyi in Burma, who was under house arrest for many years simply wanting to have an opposition party and exercise her democratic rights. She's now a member of the parliament in that country. Again, if you had asked me during the dark days of her detention, would you expect her to be a member of parliament? The answer would probably have been no. And finally, Dilma Rousseff in Brazil, also arrested by the state, allegedly tortured, now president of Brazil, running again for president. She's in the runoff election at the moment and doing reasonably well, but also set up a Truth and Reconciliation Commission in Brazil for the 21 years of military rule from 1964 to 1985. At a mass level, we also see this motivation coming in young people, old people, and those that are worried about the systems we confront today. We see, for example, here in Zuccotti Park, I took this picture visiting the Occupy movement several years ago and listened to the stories that people were telling. This, of course, yielded the famous claim about the 99% versus the 1%. We see equal and similar motivations in the Arab Spring countries, where simple claims about economic justice and rights and corrupt regimes led to massive regime change in the region owing to collective mobilization around particular sets of rights claims and ideas. And today in Hong Kong, we see our Hong Kong colleagues standing up for some rights of participation in the choice of their leader. These are movements that motivate us and make us think about what matters the most to us from an individual level to a collective level. So I'd like to leave you with a few thoughts about what that might mean for you today. And I draw on a famous political sociologist from Yale University named James Scott, who's written a wide range of books about peasant rebellion and modernization and modern projects. And he has this fantastic quote in his book called The Weapons of the Weak. And he says here, "Just as millions of anthrozoan polyps create willy-nilly a coral reef, so do the multiple acts of insubordination and evasion create political and economic barrier reefs of their own." If we can imagine the struggle for human rights as incremental gains, as building that coral reef, that barrier reef that protects us from the worst forms of our own behavior, this, to me, today, represents the promise of human rights. Thank you very much.